listening to the praise and worship, mentioned to her that out of all the years that I have been a part of the Bible College, and of course many of you, some of you may know that I attended here for a few years, but I've never seen a group of young people that is more hungry for God than this group right here. I've never seen a group of young people who are desperate for Him more than what I'm seeing here this morning. And I cannot believe my eyes and what I see. And it thrills me to say that this is just the beginning. It is just the beginning. God is doing something here amongst us and amongst you that is just the tip of the iceberg. Mark my words, and I will deal with this in the message, but mark my words, this is going to be a too small of a venue to hold them all. But they're coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west. There is no other Bible college on the planet like JJSBC, where the Spirit of God is evident. And I'm grateful and excited to see young folk hungry for a move of God. Thank you, singers and musicians. Give the Lord one more hand clap of praise. Come on, you can do better than that. I'm not going to hold you long here this morning. Just for about, give me about 30 to 40 minutes of your time. And we will send you on your way. John chapter 14. Turn with your Bibles if you can. Gospel of St. John, the 14th chapter, beginning in verse number 12, reading 12, 13, and 14. John chapter 14, beginning in verse 12. Jesus would say, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he who believes on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it." And I want to use for subject ministering just for a few moments here this morning. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. Bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that there is freedom in this place. We thank you for the Spirit of God that is moving amongst us here today. We ask for your anointing, O God. We ask for the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the leading and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We ask that you administer to us. We ask it in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said,
amen.
Everybody said,
amen.
It had to have been, I guess I would say around 2002. Brother Larson can correct me on the date, but it had to have been around that time. As I mentioned just a moment ago, that I attended what then was called World Evangelism Bible College for a year, and then moved away for about 2.5 years and came back and attended classes here once again for, I guess, about a year and a half or something to that magnitude. I don't recall what class that Brother Larson was teaching that morning. But as is obvious and the custom, of course, and I believe it still is, that every class that a student will give a devotion. And a student will share a devotion, take prayer requests, and pray before the class begins. And it just so happened that upon this morning as I got to class, Brother Larson was a few minutes late. He was taking care of some things in his office. There was a sheet that was on the wall that let us know in alphabetical order what order that the devotions were going to go in. And as I looked to the list, I knew that I was supposed to be the next one in line for the following class. However, the individual in front of me decided not to attend. And I waited for a few moments, hoping that that person would just miraculously appear and show up, because in all honesty, I had nothing to say. And believe it or not, I was still a little shy about getting up in front of people and speaking in front of people. I was not comfortable doing that. I know you wouldn't look at me and say that now, but back then I was not comfortable doing that. But I waited for a minute or two and realized that that person was not coming. And somebody in the class turned around and said, "Gabe, you need to get up there because class is about to start." And I'm stalling as much as I can. But in my heart, I'm saying, if I'm supposed to go here today, then Lord, you're going to have to give me something, because I don't know what to say. I could just go up there and just read a scripture verse and give my thoughts for about 2 minutes and then get up, get down as quickly as I can. But for whatever reason, I just begin to ask the Lord in my heart, "Lord, give me something." He spoke to my heart, and I turned over to the Gospel of St. John, the 11th chapter, and began to deal with the story of Lazarus. And the miracle of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. And I begin to minister just for a moment or two, and then all of a sudden, something came out of my mouth that, in all honesty, startled me. It was not something that I had planned. It was not something that I was formulating in my mind. But as I sat there and I stood there behind that makeshift podium in that classroom on the fourth floor of this building, I made the statement something like this: that Satan has tried to shut down the doors of this Bible college, but God is about ready to resurrect it. God is about ready to resurrect this Bible college. I also mentioned, as it came out of my mouth and it startled me once again, that every building on this side of the street, and in fact every building on this property, will return to its original function. When I said it, the power of God fell in that classroom. Tears began to roll down my cheeks as those words just came out of my mouth. And I want to say it once again, that I do believe that this was the word of the Lord for us at that moment, some 15 years ago, that every single building regarding the Bible college will go back to its original function. Well, you don't hear me here this morning. This was not meant to be a chapel room. This was meant to be a cafeteria, and it's going to go back to a cafeteria. You got a classroom over there across the way that it wasn't meant to be a classroom. It was meant to be a large cafeteria teeming with young people and people from all over the country. That's going to go back to a cafeteria. The kitchen is not going to be rented out any much longer, but it's going to be used for the gospel of Jesus Christ for these young people right here. This whole building that's right over here, it's not going to be rented out by a bank, but it's going to be a seminary for the gospel of Jesus Christ. These dormitories are not going to be rented out by people looking for rent, but it's going to be teeming with young folks coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west, learning the Lord. The original chapel for Jimmy Swagger Bible College was Family Worship Center. Guess what? It's going to go back to that. It's going to Glory to God. I sat there that moment and I trembled as those words came out of my mouth. And I likened it to that. And the Lord, I believe, spoke to it to me. That as he likened this story to Lazarus, that he's using this. This is going to be a Lazarus experience. It wasn't by chance that just about a year ago as we met, that we changed the name from World Evangelism Bible College back to Jimmy Swagger Bible College. Oh, I wish I had somebody that would get that. It wasn't by chance that we changed the name back, which means this is the beginning of the resurrection process. This is the beginning of what God is doing. The Spirit of God fell in that classroom. We didn't have class that morning per se regarding to the teaching, but the Holy Spirit showed up. That's been some 15, 16 years ago, and I believe it's going to happen. Now you see, understand this, everything God does, there is a timing. Things have to be done in His timing. He will give us things little here, little there, but precept must be upon precept. Precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little. And what we've experienced this morning is just a little.
Yes.
Oh, yes. It's just a little. It's just a little. It's just a little. You know, as I sat there in the back and I watched this, as I watched some of these singers and musicians, and they were worshiping and they put down the microphones and begin to sing, and those were the musicians were running. I mean, leaving their instruments and running. You think of that, and some may say that's a little bit crazy. No, that's normal. That's not crazy. That should be normal. That's not crazy. That is normal. Because when you've got the Holy Ghost on the inside of you, you just can't walk it. You've got to shout a little bit. You've got to dance a little bit. You've got to run a little bit. This ain't dead and cold and dry, but the Spirit of life is in this place. What we're seeing here is just the beginning. I believe that. It's just the beginning. It's just the beginning. It's just the beginning. I want you to believe that. This is just the beginning. This is just the beginning. This is not the end. This is just the beginning. It's not the end of our story. It's just the beginning of our story. It's not the end of your story. It's the beginning of your story. God is on the move. And I believe we're going to see it. There was a message in tongues and interpretation in Crossfire given. But Brother Bob here some about 6 months ago, and I still hold to that. As the word of God was given, he said, your eyes shall see it, and my word will not return void. Your eyes will see it, and my word will not return void. It's going to happen. Things are just picking up. As the old saying goes, business is just picking up. Glory to God. Now, I want to talk to you for a moment, and I told my grandparents I'd be done by 11:30, so give me about 25 minutes and I'll be done. Maybe. Jesus is nearing the end of his earthly ministry. The crucifixion was right before him. And whenever you begin to read and study in your word, the 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th chapters of the Gospel of St. John, you are reading the last will and testament of the Lord Jesus Christ here on earth. The last will and testament of our Master. And he would say in verse number 12, talking to those disciples, saying, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Now what is he referring to here? First of all, before we get into that, I want to look at one word that is the key and at the heart of this passage, and that is believe.
Yes. Yes.
God cannot work with people who don't believe Him.
That's right. That's right.
God cannot work with people who do not believe Him.
Yes.
It is without faith, it is impossible to believe God. It is impossible for God to do things for people who don't believe Him. But there are a group of young folk and recycled teenagers here in this auditorium here this morning that believe God. That you do believe God. That you believe that He is still the Savior. That He is still the healer. That He is still the deliverer. He is still the baptizer. That He is the healer. That He is the soon coming King. You believe that. It's evident that what we see is not just hype. It's not just fleshly emotion. But it's a group of people who believe that God is able to do the absolute impossible. When you got one person that believes God that He's able to do the impossible, that's phenomenal. But when you've got 75, 80 to 100 people that believe God, He's able to do the impossible. Tell them, look out. Tell them, look out. Tell them, look out. Hey, but it has to be anchored in the right object. You have been taught, for many of you, this is your first year. For others, this is your second, third, and possibly fourth year. You have been taught, you are being taught about your faith. About where it should be anchored. The object of your faith, which should be the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. If your faith is not anchored properly in Jesus Christ, who He is, and what He has done for you, you cannot experience more abundant life. But you're experiencing it right now because you know where your faith is at. Whenever Rachel was singing that song, "I'm Free to Run," I'm free to dance. I'm free to live for you. Do you realize what that means? Do you realize what that means? I spoke to the man who wrote that song. I spoke to him over the phone about a year ago, and we talk every once in a while. He's not from the United States. I believe he's from Australia. I don't even think he understands truly what that song means. I don't think he really understands the truth of those statements and those phrases. That phrase, "I'm free to run." Why are you free? Because of what Jesus Christ did. Why are you free to run? Because of what He accomplished at Calvary 2,000 years ago. You're free here this morning because of what Jesus Christ accomplished. Everything that we receive as a believer came by way of what Jesus Christ did at Calvary's cross. Now, He goes on to say this. He says, "He who believes on Me, the works that I shall do, he shall do also." Now, what is He saying here? If you have been attending Crossfire the last several months, you have realized and understood that we have been doing a study on the book of Acts. We're on Acts chapter 2, the Acts 2 experience. And Wednesday night, just this past Wednesday night, and the previous one before that, you heard me refer to this passage of Scripture. That greater works shall you do. Greater works. Now, what is He meaning by this? Number one, what are the works that He's referring to? This is Jesus talking, telling His disciples that what I'm doing, you'll do greater. What I'm doing, you'll do greater. What I do, you'll do greater. There's a meaning this. Jesus is saying, my thing is right here in Israel. This is where my ministry is. It is to the nation of Israel. But He's telling the disciples, greater works shall you do. Greater works, because it's not confined to just Israel. He's speaking of the entirety of the world. He is not just refining it to one single location. But He is saying, now that I go to My Father, I will send you someone else to give you power to go forth and to finish what I've started. Oh, I wish I had somebody that would get this. You as a believer are not supposed to sit on the sidelines watching everyone else do something for God. You are not to sit here and do nothing. You are not to sit here and just go to classes every day. You're not just called to sit here and just listen every day. Now, that's a good thing you do, but you're called to do something. You're called to act on something. And God has sent the precious Holy Spirit to you to fulfill and to make sure that we as His people continue the works of Christ while on earth. What are these works? John the Baptist, when he was in prison, he would send his disciples and say, ask Jesus if He is the one that we're looking for. Or are we looking for somebody else? And Jesus would respond to them, you tell John the Baptist. You tell John. He said, you tell him that the blind see. You tell him the lepers are cleansed. You tell him deaf ears are unstopped. You tell him that bondages are broken. You tell him that demons are being cast out. You tell him that the dead are being raised. These are the works that he's referring to. What Jesus did, you have the power to do it. Oh, I wish somebody would get this. You mean me? You mean little old me? I'm from Minnesota, don't you know? I'm from Louisiana, don't you know? I'm from Tennessee, don't you know? I'm a nobody. You might be thinking that you are nobody, but in the eyes of God, you're somebody. In the eyes of God, you're an ambassador to Jesus Christ. He said, greater works shall you do. Because why did he say that? First of all, while Jesus was here, the disciples did not need the Holy Spirit because He was there to meet their need. He was there in the flesh to meet whatever their need was. But that's why He told His disciples, I've got to go away. But when I do go away, I'm not leaving you alone. I'm going to send you another comforter. I'm going to send you somebody that's going to walk alongside of you to help you, to live inside of you, and to help you regarding your call. Greater works shall you do. That means this, that because of the Holy Spirit working inside of you, you have the ability to stand in power.
Yes.
Lord, I wish somebody would get this. You may say, well, I'm weak. Yes, you are weak, but in Him, you're strong. Amen. Greater works shall you do. All right. Then He said, and whatsoever you shall ask in My name, that will I do. I want you to think about that for a moment, ladies and gentlemen. He said, in My name. What is He referring to here regarding in My name? Have you ever heard of the term power of attorney? Yes. Some of you adults have. How many young people, raise your hand if you heard that statement, power of attorney? Do you know what that means? Somebody give me a definition of power of attorney. Uh-oh, I heard that. Huh?
Using someone else's name.
Using somebody else's name? What else? Anybody else?
You give someone the right to legally use your name to sign on your behalf.
Come on now.
You agree to everything that is in the contract that they are signing your name for.
There you go. That's a perfect definition for it. I'll read it and make it a little bit clearer than that. This means the power of attorney is a letter or a written document with authorization to represent or act on another's behalf, whether in private affairs, in business, or some other legal matter. You want to talk about power of attorney? We have it right here. Whatsoever you shall ask in My name. That's my power of attorney. He said, whatever you shall ask in My name. That's my legal representation to say in the name of Jesus Christ. Not mine. What I'm doing is not my business. What I'm a part of is not my business. These are not my affairs. I'm a part of God's business. I'm a part of His business. What I'm doing is His affairs. What you're doing is not your business. What you're doing here is not your affairs. It's God's. to use his name on his behalf for his business. His business. What is his business? To spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he saves, that he heals, that he delivers. This is our power of attorney. This statement is our power of attorney. And it is given to the purpose of every believer to fulfill and carry on the work of Christ. The work of Christ. That's why Luke would say in Acts 1:1, all that Christ began to do and teach, we are to continue. We see that in the lives of the early church. We see it outlined in the book of Acts. When you study the book of Acts, what do you see? Well, let's repeat this. Let's start here. When you talk about Jesus and you study the life of Jesus, what do you see in the life of Jesus? Miracles. You see bondages broken. You see deaf ears unstopped. Demons being cast out. The dead raised. Lepers cleansed. You see that. What do you see in the book of Acts in the lives of the disciples? You see the same thing. You see miracles being done. You see people being baptized with the Holy Spirit. You see people added to the church. You see dead raised. You see bondages broken. What we talk about in the book of Acts is a guideline for how the church should be. It's not a fairy tale. It's what we should be like. It's what the church should be like. As I said, what we experienced here this morning, that should be the norm. Not the exception. It should be the norm. Because of what God has given to us, based upon the purpose and the purpose of his will. He said, whatever you ask in my name. Now I've got to ask this question. What are the qualifications to use that name? Somebody asked, somebody answered that. What are the qualifications to use the name of Jesus? Gotta be saved. That's number one. You gotta be saved. You gotta be bought with a price. You gotta be delivered. You gotta be set free. You've gotta be saved by the power of Jesus Christ, by the blood of Jesus Christ. What's another one? There's only two requirements.
Faith.
Nope. That's we talked about that. There's two requirements. The first one is being saved. What's the second?
Filled with the Holy Ghost.
Being baptized with the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Oh my Lord. Amen. The two qualifications to use his name with power is you got to be saved and baptized with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking with other tongues. Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 8, in essence he was telling him, don't do anything until you've been first baptized with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking with other tongues. The Holy Spirit is the power source that we have to do what we ought to do and to be what we ought to be. Without the Holy Spirit, nothing can be done for the cause of Christ. I had a guy at IYC, a youth pastor, and I'll say it here, is this being recorded in any way? Okay, you can edit this part out when you need it. I had an Assembly of God youth pastor come up to me. And he said, I enjoyed your message, but I disagree with you on one thing. I said, what is it? He said, I don't believe that you have to have the Holy Spirit to do something for God. I said, well, hold on for a second. I said, what? He said, I don't believe you need to be baptized with the Holy Spirit to do something for God. I said, brother, have you read the book of Acts?
Yeah.
He said, yeah. I said, well, what do you think about the book of Acts? Well, you know, that's the book of Acts. And I said, well, what about Acts chapter 1 where Jesus himself told his disciples, don't do anything until you've been baptized with the Holy Spirit? Well, I agree with that, but I really don't think that nothing can be done for the cause of Christ if you don't have the baptism with the Holy Spirit. I said, brother, the only thing that's being done for the cause of Christ is done by those who are baptized with the Holy Spirit because they have the power.
Yeah,
come on. Jesus said, you shall receive weakness. You shall receive power, miracle working power, to do what God has called you to do. This ministry here is an example of that. If there was no Holy Spirit, you wouldn't be here. If there was no Holy Spirit, I wouldn't be here. If there was no Holy Spirit, this church would not be here. If there was no Holy Spirit, this college would not be here. If there was no Holy Spirit, these dormitories would not be here. If there was no Holy Spirit, this network would be on the air. If there's no Holy Spirit, none of us would be here. But because of the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit working in my grandfather's life, God used him to build a worldwide ministry. Holy Spirit, it is one of the greatest resources that you have as a believer to do what God has called you to do and to be what you ought to be for God. We need another Pentecost. We need another Pentecost. We've got to have another Pentecost. So the two qualifications is to be saved and baptized with the Holy Spirit. And I'm closing with this. In what capacity can we use the name of Jesus? In what capacity? Turn to Mark. The 16th chapter of the Gospel of St. Mark, the last chapter. Mark 16. How are we to use his name? He gives us the instructions on how to use his name. He says this, and these signs in verse 17 shall follow them that believe in my name. Shall they cast out devils? In my name shall they speak with new tongues. In my name shall they put away demon spirits. In my name they shall have protection. In my name they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall.
Amen.
How do we to use his name? For these very reasons right here. To cast out devils. Do you realize that there is a power greater than the powers of darkness residing in you? You should never be scared of a demon-possessed person. Because there is something greater in you. There is something greater or someone greater in you. Now I know as a child we can get a little bit freaked out at times to see this, but guess what? He has given us the authority in his name, the power of attorney to cast out devils. Cast out demon spirits.
Hallelujah.
Cast them out. In the name of Buddha? No. In the name of Muhammad, that will do anything. In the name of Gabriel, the devil will laugh at that. But when you say the name of Jesus, when you say in the name of Jesus, when you say in the name of Jesus, there is power in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Power. In the name Jesus, to cast out devils. In my name they shall speak with new tongues. That means this, Jesus is the baptizer, not us. Man is not, Jesus is. And how we do it? In the name of Jesus, be ye filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Then he says, take up serpents. I am not a snake God. I hate snakes. Somebody sent me a video of a person that was playing with a snake. I just deleted it and didn't even watch it. They're evil. They look evil. They look slimy. Their little tongue that sticks out and goes back in. I don't think so. There are a ton of other things that I'd like to do than being in a room with a snake. When I was a kid, about 13 years old, I was visiting my grandparents in Mississippi. My mom's parents. And they had a little potted plant that was hanging in the carport. And I was standing with my brother, my sister, my cousins in that carport. And all of a sudden, out of the corner of my eye, I saw something. And I looked, and it was a snake. Now, it was like a little gardener snake. It must have been maybe 4 feet long, 3 feet long. Maybe been 1 foot long. I don't know. But when I looked at that thing, I mean, Usain Bolt, he wouldn't have had a chance when coming up against me. I mean, I took off running, and I ran clear, not only just on the other side of the property, across the street. I don't do snakes. I don't like them. If they're around here, I stay away from them. I had to kill one about 2 years ago. That was not a pretty picture. I mean, I'm sitting there praying in tongues the whole time, saying, I mean, I had that big old gardening tool, and I mean, it was a shovel, and I'm sitting there thinking, dear God, don't let this thing just turn back and look at me. If it is, I'm gone. I came up, and that thing started slithering away, and he heard my vibrations, and I mean, with one shot, wha-pow! Yeah. That head came off, and I said, in the name of Jesus, I'm gone. But it also got me thinking, that's exactly what Jesus did to Satan 2,000 years ago. He removed his head. Glory to God. It doesn't mean you shall pick up serpents. If you believe that, go to another Bible college. It means to put away demon spirits. It means to put them away. Put away demon spirits. Put them away. Not invite them. Put them away. It says this, drink any deadly thing, doesn't mean poison. Don't drink poison, it'll kill you. Right. It just speaks of protection. It speaks that in the name of Jesus, there is a hedge of protection around you. There is a hedge of protection around each and every single one of you as a believer. He shall uphold you with the power of his right hand. He shall put that hedge around you and that nothing can penetrate that hedge, unless he lowers it. And he said, they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. It means this, we have the ability to pray for those who are sick, and use his name. That means cancer can't stand in the name of Jesus. Disease can't stand in the name of Jesus. Leukemia can't stand in the name of Jesus. Now, I don't know why God heals some and not others. That's not my business. But it's my business to pray for those in the name of Jesus Christ. That's how we are to use his name. Not to use it on anybody else. We're not to use that on another believer. But we are to use that name. That power of attorney. To destroy the works of the devil and to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. Then he reiterates it and says it again. Whatever you shall ask in my name, I will do it. But it must be according to his will. It's not talking about just willy-nilly things. What he's referring to must be his will. Don't go right out of here this service and say, in the name of Jesus, I claim a Lamborghini. Don't do that unless you're Mike Musgrove. Come on. I'm leaving with you, brother. I'm telling you that. Come on. But it doesn't mean to get what you want. You don't use this to get what you want. You do it to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. He said, if it's in his will, he will do it. Now, it doesn't mean it's going to happen overnight. What God gave me 15, 16 years ago, I didn't realize that Satan was trying to take what God has given us. I didn't realize that Satan would make a plague to steal what God has given us regarding this property. I didn't understand that Satan, in just a few years' time, would seek out to take what God has given us. But that's why God spoke to my heart. In Bible college, in Doc Stone's class, in Bible college, he said, endure until the promise has been received. Amen. Endure it. That means when he spoke something to you, when he speaks something to you, believe it, it is going to come to pass. But you have a part to play. You've got to believe it. This is going to be a testing of your faith. But he said, whatever you ask, if it's in his will, he said, I'll give it to you. There's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. If you've got bondages in your life, he's able to break the bondages. If there's sickness, he's able to heal. If you need deliverance, he's able to deliver. If you need the infilling of the Holy Spirit, he's able to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He's able to meet your need, whatever it may be. And you know that word, he says, whatever you shall ask. That means whatever. There's no qualification. It's whatever, however big or small it is. If you can believe it, and it's in the will of God, then God can do it. If you can. can believe it, if it's in his will, God is able. Stand to your feet. I'm finished. Stand to your feet. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus. We thank you. We believe, Lord, in your name. We believe in your great name. God, I'm asking that you would take these humble words here this morning, that you would use them to spark faith in the heart and life of your believers. God, we're asking in your name that you would touch this Bible college one more time, that we would produce preachers of the gospel, that we would produce ministers of the gospel, that we would produce missionaries that will take this gospel all over the world, that we would produce evangelists in the name of Jesus. Lord, we claim it. We take authority over every hindering spirit, every demonic power that is trying to steal what God has given us. We take authority over it right now in the name of Jesus. We claim it in the name of Jesus. Blessings upon this college. We claim it. Blessings upon your young people. Blessings upon those that are here.
Glory, glory.
Speak to those all over the world,
yes, Lord,
about coming and attending Jimmy Swaggart Bible College. Speak to them right now that this building, that these buildings on this side of the street will be flooded with young people, flooded with teenagers, young adults, adults who want to know more about Jesus. Anoint our professors. Anoint them to teach the Word of God. Anoint them to minister the Word of God. Continue to use this chapel service as a classroom to the Holy Spirit. Lord, continue to flow amongst us. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we believe that through this Bible college, people will be saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, healed and delivered. We claim it right now in the name of Jesus. We believe it, that you're going to do it one more time, that you're going to pour out your Spirit one more time, that you're going to use this Bible college to touch the world one more time. We ask it in Jesus' name. Come on, as they sing, just slip up your hands right now. Just worship Him right now. Just start claiming it, whatever the need that it is in your life. Start claiming it right now. He's able to meet you. Use the name of Jesus.
The signs of the devil are
that vessel.
Worshippers arise.
Lord, yes, Lord.